Good morning, all the brother and sister. I really hope all of you physically healthy and mentally happy. So before we start the actual Dharma class, first I want to say something about our daily practice. Generally, when we are happy and quiet, you know, calm, so we are very happy to practice Dharma. Also, very easy to practice the Dharma in our daily life. So when we are be very unhappy, having a lot of problems around us, then we are not willing to practice the Dharma. Also, we feel so difficult to practice the Dharma, remember the teachings, and reduce the problems. This is, you know, very common for everybody. It's opposite. When we are very calm, very happy, there's no really serious problem around us. And that time, actually, we no need to, you know, apply the Dharma in that time, because somehow we already have, you know, certain amount of happiness. The problem is there, but it's not really, you know, manifest strongly around us. And that time, actually, we no really need the Dharma practice. So when we are very unhappy, we have so many problems around us. Our mind is very, you know, have a lot of destruction. And that moment, we really need to practice the Dharma. And yes, it's so difficult to practice Dharma that moment, because we really don't fully understand when I need the Dharma and also why I need to practice the Dhamma. Maitreya Buddha mentioned very clearly, the medicine and the Dharma is exactly similar. So when we sick, when we have a, you know, sort of sickness, at that moment, we need to take the medicine. We need to eat the medicine. But before we sick, so we must prepare, we must have all the medicine. Otherwise, when we are sick, there's no doctor, no medicine, then we need to be sick for many months or many years. Likewise, in daily life, we need to study Dharma. We must have all the antidotes for reducing the, you know, the negative thoughts, reducing the any kinds of problems or sufferings. Therefore, so particularly we must apply the Dharma when we are very unhappy. We must practice the Dharma when we have a serious kind of, you know, difficulties and problems. Otherwise, practicing Dharma is become, you know, kind of worthless, like a medicine. You have a lot of medicines. You have all kinds of medicine in your home. When you are sick, instead of, you know, taking the medicine which is you have, you're just going out to see new doctor. You're going to go out for buying new medicine. You are looking, you know, like a different medicine. After you bought it, the medicine, then you notice, oh, this medicine actually I already have. Then it's too late to recognize, you know, you already have the medicine. Therefore, every moment you must recognize, you must remember, I have all kinds of the Dharma medicine to elevate all kinds of emotional sufferings, mental sufferings, and the physical sufferings, you know, the outer sufferings. Here I said emotional sufferings and the mental suffering. The emotional suffering is, you know, arise, you know, depends on very particular, you know, occasion. For example, when you lost your dearest one, then suddenly you become very unhappy, very upset about it. This kind of problem is our emotional problems. Then the mental problems, you know, the inner problem is always there, like anger, attachment, ignorance, hate, envy, all kinds of the negative topics, they are always there. This we call the mental, you know, sufferings. Therefore, all the emotional sufferings we have is triggered by attachment, anger, hate, ego, jealousy. When we lost, you know, one of our dearest, like a relative, friends, your teacher, suddenly you feel very unhappy. Because this can be two reasons. One, you have a very strong attachment, or you have a very strong possessive about your teacher. Most people has this kind of mind, oh, he or she is my teacher. You have a very strong attachment. When you lost your teacher, you feel very unhappy. Somebody feel very unhappy, not the attachment towards the teacher or guru, because he feel since he left, I don't have a, you know, the proper guide for me, how to practice Dharma, how to achieve Buddhahood. This kind of, you know, kind of upset, you know, the unhappiness, not due to the attachment, due to the pure devotion. Therefore, all the emotional problem we have in our daily life actually is triggered, you know, the cause by attachment, anger, hatred, jealousy, envy, all the negative thoughts, we call the mental, you know, like a sufferings. For example, you know, now this year is the second year of the COVID. So right now we are not supposed to, you know, eat in the restaurant. We are not supposed to go together, not more than 2%. When there's a rules, suddenly we feel it's very unhappy. This is emotional problems. So in order to reduce all the, you know, this kind of emotional problems, first we must control the mental problems, the negative thoughts. Then doesn't matter, you can eat inside, you know, inside the restaurant, you eat outside, you eat in your house, for you have a same kind of, you know, feeling. Therefore, I really, you know, urging for all of you, most of you are very, you know, beginner in Dharma. Also, most of you are very new. You believe in Dharma, but you are very new to know why I need to practice, when I should practice, how long I should practice. Therefore, everybody always remember the Dharma is like the most important medicine. The general medicine, the physical medicine, the medicine which is physical, it can reduce the physical sufferings, not the emotional sufferings, not the mental sufferings. For example, somebody has a very strong depression. Then the doctor, you know, gives like the physical medicine. When the person checked and took the physical medicine, suddenly the person feel become quite calm. You know, all the mind is not, you know, active very strongly. It doesn't mean that the physical medicine can reduce, eliminate the emotional problem, because the physical medicine cannot control the mind, the mental problems, the negative thoughts, cannot control the negative thoughts. So every moment when you have any kinds of problem, first you ask this question, why I am not happy? Ask this question yourself and try to understand the main trigger, the main cause make you very unhappy. Then there's a two condition. One is the immediate, the external condition, for example, losing your dear one, you know, losing your job, losing your position, losing your healthy, or losing your kind of things, or having, you know, big fighting with your friends and family. These are the external conditions. You must think, yes, I'm not happy because those of this is this. Then you ask another question, second question, why this thing happened around me? Then the answer will be, yes, in within yourself, you have an anger. Due to the anger, hatred, you have a fighting. Due to have a, you know, anger, attachment, jealousy, then you have all the, you know, external problem. Then you must apply the Dharma to control the unwholesome mind, all the negative thoughts. Then after you practice Dharma for a few weeks, or even though a few days, few hours, you feel very happy. You feel the calmness, the happiness, because you really control the root of the sufferings. So when I say, when you through applying Dharma, you feel good about, you feel happiness, you feel calmness. It's not just saying, you must go through your own experiment. Then you have a experience. For example, last night, you have a, you know, very strong argument with someone. When you woke up early morning, suddenly you remember this person, you remember all the arguments, then suddenly you become, you feel very unhappy, unhappiness, you be with unhappiness. Then you ask question, you no need to question why I'm not happy today, because argument. Why have an argument? Then you focus on the negative thoughts. And practice love and compassion for the person for 10 minutes. 10 minutes, suddenly you feel very calm, happy. That means you can feel, you know, you can have a direct benefit through practice of Dharma. Therefore, at the beginning, I really, you know, requesting all of you, you must practice Dharma when you really need it. When you don't really need it, still you must keep the Dharma continuously in your mind stream, ready to fight all the problems. Therefore, at the beginning, first everybody visualize Buddha Shakyamuni, not picture, not statue, you just visualize actual Buddha Shakyamuni person in front of you. And take refuge to the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. Also visualize all sentient beings around you. And generate love. And wish to be Buddha to benefit all sentient beings. In order to be a Buddha, we need to practice the three important course, which is compassion, bodhicitta, the wisdom. Within these three course, first, we need to practice compassion. The compassion can be practiced if we are able to practice the love, the pure love, the unbiased love, the pure and unbiased love can be practiced if we are able to practice equanimity. If you have the equanimity mind towards all sentient beings. Therefore, first, among the all sentient beings, you visualize just one sentient beings, neither your friend nor your enemy. So when we visualize the neutral person, we don't have a sense of attachment towards the person, nor we don't have a sense of anger hatred to the person. Nor attachment, neither anger, just visualize this person. Second, visualize or remember the particular person whom you really don't like. You visualize the both together, the neutral person and your enemy. So when we visualize our enemy, when we remember our enemy, certainly we feel the anger, we feel the hatred. Now you must have an equal mind towards the neutral person, the enemy, because the neutral person and the enemy, both of them, want happiness, don't want any kinds of suffering. You must have an equal mind. Then here, I think everybody suddenly have a question in your mind. How I can have an equal mind with my enemy and the neutral person? Because the neutral person is just so neutral for me. He or she doesn't harm me. He or she doesn't benefit me. The enemy, you consider the enemy, he or she harm me. He or she deceive me. He or she me, you know, hurt me. So how I can have a, you know, equal mind? Then the answer is here. The person who consider as your enemy, he or she harm you, hurt you, deceive you, cheat you, have a, you know, argument, have a fighting with you, we must accept. We're not saying he or she doesn't harm you, but they harm you, they hurt you, they cheated you, deceived you for this lifetime, only one time, maybe two times, maybe 1 year. Or before it, after it, still he or she can benefit for you. Also think about, you know, in the previous life, whom you consider as your enemy, he or she washed used to be your dear mother, dear father, dear friends, dear wife, dear husband, dear children. He or she harmed, deceived you only short time, only just one moment, but benefit for millions of years. If you think this way, then you can able to, you know, do the forgiveness to your enemy. Then you have a same, you know, equal mind with your the neutral person, your enemy. You need to look equally. One happiness, don't want suffering. Equally, both of them benefit you millions of years. Equanimity. Third, you visualize one of the, your dearest person. Doesn't matter your relatives, your life partner, or your friends. Doesn't matter, you visualize one of the, your dearest person next to is 2%. Then suddenly we feel very happy because we have a strong attachment, right? Then also you need to think very equal, you must have an equal mind with the neutral enemy and your dearest person. Your dearest person want happiness, doesn't want suffering. From that point of view, your friend is equal to the, you know, the your neutral and the enemy. You are same. Or there's no point to have a strong attachment towards your dearest, your closer one. Also, he or she is very good with you this life. Maybe in the past, he or she deceived you, harmed you. Therefore, first, we must have an equal mind towards this 3% neutral person, your, you know, dearest person, so your enemy and your closer person have an equal mind. Okay, now we have a very equal mind towards the neutral person, your enemy, your dearest person. Have an equal. You don't have a really attachment towards your enemy and the neutral person. Also, you should don't have a, you know, attachment towards your dearest one. You don't have a sense of anger, hatred towards your dearest person. At the same time, you shouldn't have a same kind of attachment, anger towards the neutral and enemy. Therefore, for you, your friend, your enemy, the neutral person is equal. You have an equal mind with these 3%. Next, we must have an equal mind towards, you know, rest of the sentient beings. This is how we practice equanimity, have an equal mind towards your neutral person, your enemy, your dearest one, then have a same equal mind to all sentient beings. When you have an equal mind, the equality between all sentient beings, that means you have, you know, very, you know, good land, good kind of ground to grow whatever you wish to grow. Otherwise, that there's a land, one part of land has a, you know, like a good soil, other part of the land have a bad soil. And one part of the land has a, like a kind of the moisture, other parts of the land is very dry. When you equally put the seeds on the land, you really cannot have a good kind of crops. You cannot have a good fruits. You have a little fruits, we have a good soil and land. Therefore, equanimity is looked like, you know, cultivating, you know, preparing the good land to grow any kinds of fruits and vegetables. Right? Equanimity. After you have an equal mind towards all sentient beings, then second, you must think the neutral person, the enemy, the dearest one, they equally want happiness, doesn't want suffering. Two reasons, equally want happiness, equally don't want any kinds of sufferings. Then you wish may the enemy, the neutral person, the dearest one, always be happy, have a cause of happiness. That means you are practicing love based on equanimity. Then why you have, what is your, you know, why, what the reason I need to practice love towards these people? Why I have the responsibility to practice love all sentient, why? Then you are the most important person in your family. For example, you are the most important person in your family because you have the knowledge, you have the experience, you are the capable to protect your families, benefit your families, give all the necessary conditions. You have the ability, you have the experience, then you have the responsibility because you are the most important person in your family because of the knowledge, experience. Likewise, you and your family has a connection. Whether you are brother or sister, father and mother, all family has the connection. As a father, you have a connection with your children. You have a connection with your wife. When your wife is sick, you must take care of your wife because you and your wife has an important relationship. When your children sick, as a father, you must take care of your children, because you and your children has a very important connection. Or if you are like a sister, important sister in your family, also you must take care of all your family equally, because they have an equal connection with you. Same idea you have, like I have. So we have a very important connection with all human beings in this lifetime. Also, we have a very important connection with all sentient beings on the planet this lifetime. Right? Then some of you think, how I have a connection with all human beings on the planet? Singapore, is a very simple way. All Singaporean give, you know, the tax, PCF, you have the PCF system, right? All your tax, how much you pay tax 1 year, this can benefit all the Singaporeans, the elderly people, the children, even the foreign worker. Right? So you benefit all Singaporeans. All Singaporeans also benefit for you. Now, what is the connection you and, you know, all the Malaysian people, Indonesian people, Thai people, Indian people, then like Indonesia, Philippines, China, European. That means when you drink a cup of tea, the water, the electricity, the tea is come through millions of people. Therefore, you have a connection. Therefore, if you are a good person, you must return their kindness. Am I right? Now, next life. So previous life. So this lifetime, we can realize I have a connection with all human beings, all sentient beings on the planet. Also, we have a connection with all sentient beings in our previous life. Therefore, you must have a responsibility to benefit all sentient beings, because you know how to benefit. You have a knowledge. Right? Therefore, second, after you have a first, you have an equal mind with the three person. The equal mind, have an equal mind, all human beings, all sentient beings. Then cultivate love. Love. Wish to be happy. Have all kinds of cause of happiness for all human beings, all sentient beings. When you have pure love, you really, really love all sentient beings. You have a loving kindness. You have a kind heart. You really purely love. Mean you have a love which is unconditional love. When you really care someone has a little problem, you put effort, free the person from suffering. Right? Based on pure love. Then second, you need to cultivate compassion, pure compassion. Then compassion, first, we already have the good foundation for cultivating compassion. Again, visualize your closer one, dear friend one. Cultivate compassion. Wish this person free from suffering, free from cause of suffering. Then the neutral person. You have an equal compassion towards your dearest one and the neutral person. When you have an equal compassion towards your dearest neutral person, Next, you visualize your enemy. Mean enemy doesn't mean you know you really want to kill him or her. Somehow you have a sense of hate. You really hate the person. Then you have a equal compassion with towards the, your enemy with the two person, your dearest and neutral person, equal compassion. Then same compassion you extend towards all sentient beings. That means you don't have a sense of any kinds of anger towards any sentient beings. You have a equally in our love all sentient beings. You have an equal compassion towards all sentient beings. Then these two conditions cause to achieve bodhicitta. Because you wish all sentient beings be happy, free from suffering. How you can free all sentient beings from suffering? How you can give all kinds of happiness to all sentient beings? How? Yes, then there's a two kind of benefit you can give. One is the temporal happiness. Who are sick, you offer medicine. Who are hungry, you food offer. Who are feel cold, you offer clothes. You give the temporal benefits. So many of we have been trying to give the temporal benefit for many people. But this moment, we don't have the ability to give temporal benefit all human beings. We don't have, but we must have a strong motivation to benefit all human beings, all sentient beings. This is temporal benefits. But you are not looking the temporal benefit, the short-term benefit all sentient being, all human being. You are looking the long-term ultimate benefits, which is free from suffering and the cause of suffering. Provide the ultimate happiness, the cause of happiness. How? Through giving, teaching. Teach them how to free from suffering. How to free from cause of suffering. We need to teach how to achieve ultimate happiness. How to achieve the cause of ultimate happiness. Therefore, without becoming Buddha, we really cannot give the right teaching all sentient beings how to free from suffering. Therefore, third bodhicitta, right? So please you remember the order. First, equanimity, equal minds. Then cultivate pure love, unbiased love, unconditional love, then pure compassion, then bodhicitta. Therefore, what Buddha said, bodhisattvas should not train many practices, train only one practice, which is great compassion. When you have great compassion, all the Buddha's qualities in your hands, omniscience also in your hands. Therefore, great compassion is the most important cause to achieve Buddhahood because of achieving, accomplishing bodhicitta. Right? Please remember the important the orders. Also, you must remember why I need to practice these orders. Then, after bodhicitta, you need to practice the important kind of methods, which is wisdom. Wisdom have a different kind of level. The most important wisdom the wisdom which is realized emptiness. You become very kind, compassionate. You are bodhisattva. If you doesn't mean I'm not, you know, I'm in, you know, exclude, I'm include too. If you don't practice wisdom, which is realized emptiness, doesn't matter how long you practice bodhicitta, doesn't matter how long you've been, you know, be bodhisattva, you never be free from suffering. You cannot other being free, you know, free from suffering, because the root is always there. Therefore, next, we need to practice emptiness, right? So these are the meditation state, equanimity, love, then compassion. In order to, you know, cultivate love, what we need to know? We need to know the benefits. What the sentient beings, you know, have been searching. All sentient beings, actually, they always for 24 hours, for 12 months, they are always looking happiness, searching happiness, chasing after happiness. You cannot find any sentient beings, I want suffering, I want problems. Even though the people who always wish to commit suicide, he or she also looking happiness. The people who really, you know, like that, always taking drug, drink alcohol, smoking, stealing, deceiving, cheating, all the cheater, deceit, you know, drunk people, they have been doing this thing because one happiness, don't want suffering, right? Therefore, you need to remember the benefit, the temporal benefit, then, you know, the ultimate benefit, the highest, you know, benefit is of becoming Buddha. Then love, then next, compassion. These three conditions, equanimity, unconditional love, unconditional compassion, then bodhicitta is not next there, next to them. Sometimes we feel, oh, becoming Buddha, bodhisattva is very difficult. Yes, in a way is very difficult if you don't practice, you know, the order. You don't practice love, compassion, equanimity in order, bodhicitta cannot accomplish. Bodhicitta cannot, then omniscient cannot. Buddhahood cannot. Next, then we need to practice the wisdom, which is realized emptiness, right? So today, I think it's 11, almost 11. So we just skip the part of identifying the nature of suffering. Identifying the nature of sufferings. So we no need to study this one because we have been talking about, you know, three types of sufferings. Also, none of us need introduction about sufferings. When you look at our own, you can see full of sufferings, full of problems. When we think about suffering, we really wish free from this suffering, this problem, these difficulties. Next, we need to learn how to free from suffering. Then suffering, I said, I mentioned many times. And this lifetime, there's a, you know, two kinds of, you know, the the outer sufferings, the external sufferings. Some external suffering can be reduced in your mind to change your perception, change your belief. For example, this day, everybody feels very insecure about the COVID. If you always keep thinking about the COVID, you know, the virus, the COVID, you know, so you feel very unhappy. You feel, you know, there's no reason to alive. This thing you can reduce when you change your perception, your idea. Simple, you think this COVID is kind of, you know, simple virus for, you know, flu. It's kind of flu virus. It can be over within few months. It can or cannot over, doesn't matter. You just think it can be over within a few months. It's not that serious problem. It makes you feel relief. Or if some of you are very worried about your job, very worried about your future. If you are very worried about job, you simple thing, until I have a breath, I'm breathing, the job is always there. I can have a job anywhere, any kinds of job I can have. I no need to worry about job. If you have a very worry about your future, also you must change your idea. Future means how long I can survive, how many years? 1 year, 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, there's no such guarantee. You can be survive 1 year, 2 years. Maybe today we survive. Tomorrow, maybe we all going to die. We never know. If you think this way, it reduces your anxiety about your future life, your future. It doesn't mean you should not care about your future. You should not make a, you know, like a plan for your future. We must do a lot of preparation for your future. How to save money, how to be, you know, how to have a healthy body, how to have a healthy mind, how to have a healthy kind of friendship or relationship. You must have a proper, do the proper preparation without having a lot of anxiety. These things can be changed when you're able to change your perception, your belief. For example, last time during the, you know, teaching from His Holiness, somebody asked a question. During the COVID, I lost my father. I'm very upset, very unhappy. His Holiness said, yes, you know, I understand. It is, you know, very unfortunate to lose your father. It doesn't mean it's end for your life. Still, you have so many your other relatives. Also, you have a same equal love and compassion towards the rest of the, your relatives. Your father already passed away, being, you know, upset. It doesn't mean, you know, he will come back. So just change your perception, then you are okay. The second problem, particularly, you know, in the modern time, people are very worried about, you know, getting older. They don't want to be older. They don't want to be old person. Whether you want or you don't want, nobody can stop become older, to be old person. It doesn't matter if you change your perception or you don't change your perception, you becoming older, you know, every moment, kind of aging. So we must have a healthy body. Vishnuti, I want to be youthful forever. This is a big mistake. Also, death. Whether you want or you don't want, death will come. We cannot escape from aging and death. Unless you don't have the physical body. So this thing, you should not worry about, you know, getting older, aging, sickness, death. It's part of our life. So if you have a body, it's changing momentarily. Then there's an aging. The one day, this body cannot support anymore. Then the body, this gross body, and the mind, we separate. The separation must become. This thing doesn't have, you know, when you change your perception, you can be youthful. It doesn't mean when you change your perception, you cannot be died. No. This thing, you know. So if you're able to change our perception, so many problems cannot see as our problems. Almost 75% of our daily problems can be kind of disappear for you. I said for you, when you change your perception. For example, there are two, you know, brother and sister next to the death body of the mother. Two brother and sister who really, you know, love the mother. They both then stay next to the dead body of mother. The sister able to realize the truth nature, able to realize, able to accept. He or she feel not so unhappy because she able to understood, accept it. The brother don't understand the death, not able to accept the dying. The brother become very unhappy. The sister is very calm and quiet, do kind of recitation, chanting, not really crying. The brother is very upset, unhappy, crying, you know, all the times. Now you can see how to change the situation when they change the perception or the idea, the thoughts. So what Buddha taught us, Buddha always taught, watch your mind. Realize the two kinds of the minds, positive and negative. You know, cultivate the positive thoughts as much as you can. Control, reduce the negative thoughts as much as you can. Then the happiness is always there. Therefore, you know, suffering, there's a many kinds of suffering. We don't need, none of us need, you know, introduction about suffering. Next, wisdom, page number 8. We have, I think, another like a half hour. The heap of the Jewel Sudara says, single pointed concentration is achieved by adhering into moral ethic. Page number 8, there's a quotation from a sutra. Single-pointed concentration is achieved by adhering to moral ethics. With the achievement of single-pointed concentration, you meditate on wisdom. Wisdom helps you to attain pure pristine awareness. Through pure pristine awareness, your moral conduct is, you know, perfect. This is very important. You can see the wisdom and ethic are interdependent. As, you know, Buddha said, single pointed concentration is achieved. How to achieve? Achieve through the moral ethic, by adhering to moral ethics. With achievement of single pointed concentration, they meditate on wisdom. Then second, wisdom helps you to attain pure pristine awareness. Through the pure pristine awareness, your moral conduct is perfected. Right? First, we need, you know, like a single pointed concentration. Single, that means very focuseful mind. We need very focuseful mind. In order to have the focuseful mind, just single pointed concentration, we need to practice ethic, right? I'm looking at the Tibetan text, there's some. Yes, I think a little bit missing. Okay. I think we start page number six is better. Page number six. Bodhicitta is of the two types, conventional and ultimate. The conventional bodhicitta is the cultivation of the initial through the aspire to attain unseparable and perfectly consummate Buddhahood in order to benefit all wandering sentient beings. After having taken the vows of the compassion to release all of them from suffering, the conventional bodhicitta should be cultivated in the process similar to the described in the chapter one. That means there's two types of bodhicitta, conventional and ultimate. The conventional bodhicitta can be cultivated through pure love, compassion, then altruism. Then you can achieve Buddhahood. Right. Then after you cultivate bodhicitta, then you need to take a vows. Right. Also, we study in the limb of the path. There's a two different ways you can take the vows, Bodhisattva vows, in front of the your actual guru or in front of the holy object. Vows is very simple. For example, you know, when you see killing is very bad, you really, you know, have a strong conviction, killing is very bad. You think killing is very bad. Then you have a commitment since today, I'm not going to kill any sentient beings. This means commitments is a promise or vows. Same way, when you think in order to benefit all sentient beings, I want to be Buddha. I can be Buddha if I practice bodhicitta. Then you have a very strong conviction, you know, practicing bodhicitta. You knew the practice of bodhicitta is very important. Then you have a commitment. Since today, I will practice bodhicitta until I become a Buddha. Then you have a commitment. You have a promise that you are, that means you are taking vows. Then next, after generating the conventional awakening mind of bodhicitta, in order to cultivate the ultimate awakening mind of bodhicitta. The ultimate bodhicitta is transcendental and free from all liberation. It is extremely clear. The object of ultimate stillness, unwavering like a butter lamp, undisturbed by the wind. So after you cultivate conventional bodhicitta, then second, you cultivate ultimate bodhicitta. Not for everybody. Generally, first equanimity, then pure love, compassion, bodhicitta, then ultimate bodhicitta. It's generally like that, but it's not necessary everybody first, you know, practice conventional, second ultimate. Somebody first can, you know, practice ultimate bodhicitta, then generate conventional bodhicitta. It depends on the you know, practitioner. Generally, first conventional bodhicitta, then second is ultimate. Not necessary for everybody. So what does mean ultimate bodhicitta? After generating the conventional awakening mind of bodhicitta, in order to cultivate ultimate awakening mind of bodhicitta. The ultimate bodhicitta is transcendental and free from all elaboration. First, transcendental. What does it mean? So let's say, you know, tomorrow we everybody realize emptiness. Since you realize emptiness, all your daily perception is totally changed. That means transcendental, transcend. Until today, we are just believe what thing perceive to us, how perceive, thing perceive, we just believe, we follow based on our, you know, the gross perception. Very simple example. In the reality, all the conditioned phenomena is changing, momentarily changing. But we don't have this kind of idea, things changing momentarily. We just believe how things perceive to us. For example, you know, someone was born and stay for many years, and in the end, in the life is finished. In between, we cannot see the momentary changes. When we realize the subtle impermanence, then since our perception totally will change. Second, until now, whatever thing perceived to us, everything look like for us, look like everything exists inherently. Inherently, everything look like, you know, established from the object side, nothing to do with the subject side. We believe this way. When we realize emptiness, It looks like we are living in the kind of, you know, illusion. We are living in a dream. Since our perception has changed, therefore, transcendental. Ultimate bodhicitta is transcendental. The second set, free from, you know, elaboration. Free from all elaboration. I mean, all kinds of, you know, thoughts, the negative thoughts, misperception, misunderstanding thoughts. When we realize emptiness, actually emptiness, attachment can be controlled, anger can be controlled, ego, jealousy, everything can be controlled. Because right now, we are just have an attachment with the illusion horse. You know, illusion horse, illusion money, illusion position. Actually, you don't have, you know, the gold in your hands, but somebody produce you a illusion gold in your hand, then you have a so strong attachment. When you lost the gold in your hand, you feel very upset. When you realize the gold in your hand is the illusion, right? Then the gold in your hand, you don't have an attachment. You should not have a sense of happiness. When you lost the gold, we don't have a sense of, you know, angry, unhappiness, because we realize the gold in my hand is illusion. Therefore, when we realize all the, you know, when we realize emptiness, the attachment so attached to the beautiful object, beautiful person, going to disappear. That means, you know, the elaborate thoughts, no more there. When we realize the anime, the person is merely designated phenomena, then since anger, since realized emptiness, no more anger, no more ego, no more kind of jealousy. Therefore, free from all illiberation. It is extremely clear. The object of the ultimate, stainless, unwaving, like a butter lamp, undisturbed by wind. Clear, was extremely clear. Means, we just imagine, you know, you are just enjoying your food in the nice, you know, environment. Suddenly, your enemy appeared. How your mind became very disturbing, right? So when we meditate on emptiness, when we meditate, so first we need to realize emptiness. Second, we meditate on emptiness. While we are meditating emptiness, look, your mind is totally free from all the negative thoughts. It's very pure, very kind of, you know, very calm and very pure. Therefore, I say here, say very clear. Then the object of ultimate, that means emptiness is the actual object for meditation. While you are, you know, meditating on bodhicitta, anger can be arise sometimes, attachment can be arise, jealousy can be arise. But when you realize emptiness, since all the negative thoughts can be controlled. Therefore, the object of ultimate, stainless, unwaving, like a butter lamp, undisturbed by the wind. Right now, we have so many disturbing minds, right? So many, some looks, some beautiful object appear, attached. ugly object appear to us, be angry. Something happened, something good happened to someone, be jealous. Some little good thing happened to us, ego arise. Right? This is, we can tell based on our experience. Because our mind is look like, you know, butter lamb between the wind. The wind is just, you know, going around the butter lamb. Just imagine how the butter lamb is. It's flaking, 24 hour flaking. Cannot really stay stillessly. Cannot stay, you know, without moving. Because the wind is around the butter lamb, moving around. Therefore, beautiful object come, our minds move. Ugly object come, move other direction. Therefore, our mind is totally disturbed for 24 hours. Even our dream, the mind got disturbance because of the, all the negative thoughts. Since we realize emptiness, our mind become very stillness, you know, undisturbed by the wind. This is telling the, you know, the important feature of emptiness, right? So next we will discuss about emptiness. Then we discuss more about meditation. So today we can stop here our class. So we have still have a few minutes. We can discuss. If there's any question, please feel free to ask question.
Yes, Geshe-la, there's questions. So even if we practice compassion toward people around us, like family, colleagues, customers, but from time to time, some person is against towards our thoughts due to different values, belief, or religion. So how shall we think about this group of people? Do we just leave them as they are, or still give compassion to take good care of them? And also we are wondering if we have to sacrifice to still give compassion to people who do not appreciate and which sometimes burn out ourselves.
Also similar question, somebody text me after the last Sunday class. The person says, for me, very easy to cultivate compassion towards all sentient beings, except my mother and my husband. Right? Because a person wish mother always be healthy, but sometimes she eats unhealthy food, then she lost compassion. She wished the husband stop smoking, then husband have a healthy life, and the husband can live longer life. So when she husband stop smoking, husband, you know, doesn't listen, then she get angry. She cannot have a compassion. She asked mother stop eating unhealthy food. Mother doesn't stop, she get angry. Right? The same question. Do you remember Lama Tsongkhapa said? Without turn yourself, you should not think you turn others. Without taming yourself, you cannot turn others. In order to tame others, first you tame yourself. So practicing compassion is not for changing others. You should not think, you know, I wish I change this person, that person. So if you practice unconditioned love and compassion, then you won't have a these kind of problems. Yes, when you practice Dharma, all your Dharma practice, you must practice very secretly. You no need to show, you no need to tell, I'm Buddhist. You no need to tell, oh, I practice compassion every day towards everybody, all sentient beings. Now other people think, oh, you are very strange. Somebody deceive you, somebody harm you, still you are practicing the compassion. The person think, oh, you are something wrong. The first, all our practice, we must do very secretly, very hiddenly. While we are practicing compassion or love, the obstacle always come. Due to your families, due to your friends, due to, you know, who follow different kind of tradition. You always think me and all those people are equal to be happy, equal to be, you know, equal to be free from suffering. A little kind of disturbing, you know, cannot affect my practice. If you practice compassion secretly, which is very unconditional love, then any kind of obstacle won't affect to you. And also, as a beginner of, you know, practitioner, particularly beginner of the compassion practitioner, you practice compassion in your, you know, like a mental level, not the action level. You should not really take action out of love and compassion. Suddenly you think, oh, compassion is very important. I must have a compassion of everybody. When you go through the practical level, then suddenly become, you know, very great obstacle to practice your compassion. For us, look like we just freshly, you know, grow, sprout. If somebody step on it, the fresh sprout going to dry. So our mind is, you know, very fragile. Our mind is not so stable, particularly the love and compassion is very fragile or very unstable. We should not practice the compassion in the practical level until you have the strong mind, right? So this is, I think, a simple answer for you. Still, I think we need to discuss more precisely. Yes, next question, please.
Yeah, Keshila. In cultivating the four immeasurables, we meditate daily on first, causes of happiness for all our dear mother sentient beings, which is loving kindness. Number two, for all our dear mother sentient beings to be free from causes of suffering, which is great compassion. Then number three, for all our mother sentient beings to be blessed with immeasurable joy, never separated from the causes of happiness and free from the causes of suffering. Then number four, for all our mother sentient beings to abide in equanimity, free from aversion and bias for some. Mm-hmm. Is it of any significance that this should be in this order? For example, some practitioners start from number four, equanimity.
Yes. First, equanimity is very important. First, equanimity. Without equanimity, you can practice love and compassion. Then the love and compassion cannot be the great and pure love and compassion. The first equanimity also, you know, based on the middle stage of meditation. Also, generally, the farmer, all the farmers, in Singapore, we don't have a lot of any farmers. When you look at the farmer, how they cultivate the hops. First, they check the land is not so wet, not so dry. They wait until the soil become very cultivatable soil. Exactly. If we don't have equanimity, equal for all, look, you know, have a idea, look equally all sentient beings, then you have a love, compassion to someone, you have a hatred to someone, then you cannot cultivate pure love and compassion forever. The first equanimity. When you have an equanimity, then you must practice, you know, the great immeasurable love. Then love, then you can see, you know, the immeasurable of blissness. Then immeasurable of compassion. This is the order. Without having, you know, immeasurable equanimity, there's no way you can practice great love and compassion. Verbally, you can say, I practice. Practically, cannot. Without having the proper cultivation land, you cannot cultivate the, you know, the hops equally on the land. Therefore, you must have an equal, you know, land. All possible land must be equal, not so wet, not so dry. You know, some area has a lot of stone, some part of land has a lot of sand. Then you cannot cultivate equally the hops or the land. Yes. Can you tell me which text said, you know, you practice equanimity in the loss?
No, it just says that some practitioners start from equanimity, but not from any text.
Yeah, the first equanimity is correct. Next question. Any question or no question? Since 8th of August till I think 6th of September, from 8th August to 6th September, we do the Olambana, you know, 1 month sur offerings. The sur offering is a very important, you know, practice to benefit all sentient beings, particularly the hungry beings, the local gods and local deities. Also important practice to benefit the decent, you know, person. So until last year, so we didn't do the Olambana sur offering. You as a Singaporean, you can follow, I think, your tradition, the burning kind of, you know, the paper and clothes and so and so. Then I thought, why not for the 1 month we do a sur offering in the very proper and correct practice to benefit all sentient beings, particularly all the descent and also the hungry beings, also the local deity and gods, particularly who owns, you know, the karmic debtor. So we will start from 8th of August until 6th of August. Mostly I'll do the prayer in the evening, maybe 5:30 to 6. It's a short puja, but very important. I just let you know. So how much, you know, they us to contribute, I don't know. So if you're interested, you can contact to office. Also for the 1 month, so according to your culture, you believe it's kind of, you know, 1 month, all the hungry ghosts in the door open. So there's no such as things there. Therefore, for the 1 month, you can chant Om Mani Padme Hum, the mantra of the all of the Shura, to benefit all sentient beings, particularly all the, you know, hungry beings. So you can chant like 10 times, 20 times, 100 times per day is up to you. Not there suddenly, you know, you say 100 times, 300 times. You just recite Om Mani Padme Hum maybe 10, 20 times. And the merit, you can dedicate towards all the hungry beings, all the local deities and local gods, all the descent beings. Okay, so this I want to mention you. So thank you so much for attending the Sunday class. Everybody, please be healthy and be safe. At the end, we do dedication prayers as usual. Chanju Ozen Jorim Boje Maje Panamanke Gyur Kewa Nyamba Meba Yangkuni Kondo Pewar Shu Kewa Kondo Yanda Lama Dande Meche Ge Pala Longju Sadan Lange Yende Razo Doje Changi Koban Yurdo Shu Jide Yambe Gevan Dange Mine Chune Zase Azadin Madru Moge Guba Gunjin Sirin Neme Dehi Dembar Shu Thank you so much. Have a happy Sunday. Thank you.